Hi students, today we have some questions from general chemistry, more questions from general chemistry, mostly from inorganic chemistry. Let's go through the questions. The first question, there is no SS bond in 1 S2O4 to minus, S2O5 to minus, S2O3 to minus and S2O7 to minus. We will check the structures of each one by one. See, S2O4 to minus, it is called dithionite, I-T-E, dithionite ion. Here, two SO2 groups are bonded through one S single bond. S double bond O, single bond O minus, such two groups are bonded through S single bond. So, please remember this structure also along with it, its name. Okay, so we see that it is having an SS single bond. Now the next one, S2O5 2 minus. See, H2O4 2 minus we have gone through. So when the next compound is H2O5 2 minus, we would think that one oxygen would be inserted in between 2S, but it is not so. It is having an unsymmetrical structure with a still continuing to have SS bond, and one sulfur is having three oxygen atoms, two double bonded oxygen atoms and one O minus, whereas the other, as in dithionic acid, continue to have S double bond O and one O minus. So it has an unsymmetrical structure, and also he is having one SS bond. It is also called metabisulfite. Don't forget the names. Disulfide, actually it is not a proper name, it is not having the same two units, so it is improper to call it disulfide. It is otherwise called a metabisulfite. Okay, we go to, so this is also our, not our answer, so we go to the next one. Thiosulfate ion, look, you know, you are familiar with the sulfate ion where there is one central sulfur with the two double bonded O and two single bonded O minus. Here one of the double bonded O is replaced by double bond S. So its formula changes from SO4 2 minus to S2O3 2 minus, thiosulfate ion. It is also having SS bond, here double bond. Thiosulfate we are familiar with in iodometry and iodometric titrations, where hypo, where it is known as hypo, sodium thiosulfate. Its ion is called a thiosulfate ion. Okay. We go to the next one. Pyrosulfate or disulfate ion. Look the structure. Here, one oxygen is inserted between two sulfite ions. So, here there is no SS bond. It is actually the anion of pyrosulfuric acid or oleum, or H2S2O7, which we are familiar. So it is obtained by the dehydration from sulfuric acid, removal of one water molecule from two sulfuric acid molecule. So this must be our answer, because this molecule does not have an SS direct covalent bond. Okay, so our answer is 4. Still, I will show you one more structure in the sequence. See, it is dithionate ion. We started with the dithionite ion, where each sulfur was having two oxygen. Here each sulfur is having one more double bond O. So it is called a dithionate ion. It is also having SS bond. It is not in the options. Okay. So now we proceed to the next question. Which is bar R acidic? SiO, GeO, SiO and GeO, SiO, GeO and SnO. We know all these are oxides of the 14th group metal, monoxides of 14th group metal. Actually, this question is fully from the syllabus, fully from your textbook only. We will to get the answer, look at this chart. See here, two types of oxides. In addition to the answer, I am showing you some other information also. See, two series of oxides are given, monoxide and dioxide. Look, for a monoxide, carbon monoxide is popular for being neutral. Then SiO is acidic. you remember it is unstable, it is stable only at a very high temperature. Then GEO acidic, SNO amphoteric, PBO amphoteric. If you go to the dioxide, only CO shows a different character. Only CO2 shows a different character. It is acidic, we know, carbonic acid. All others show the same trend as on the monoxide side. Look, SiO acidic, we will check the whole list. CO neutral, but CO2 is acidic. For the rest, behavior is similar for monoxide and dioxide. SiO acidic, SiO2 acidic. GeO acidic, GeO2 acidic. SNO amphoteric, SNO2 amphoteric. PBO amphoteric, PBO2 amphoteric. See, this is the benefit of comparative study. If you separately study these two series, there's every chance that you go wrong. But if you remember them together, the benefit is double. Because you can, in comparison, remember both sets. With the, you have to specifically remember that CO alone is odd out. Why? It alone is neutral. Okay, hope you understood that. So our answer here is the third answer in the given list. You can check back. Okay, we will proceed to the next question. Look here, the correct order of dielectric constants for the given compounds. In all the set, we have the same three compounds. They are H2O, H2O2, and D2O. And this question again from our textbook only. The dielectric constant of H2O and D2O are given in their comparison chart. And the dielectric constant of H2O2 is given in its property showing chart. So it's fully from our textbook only, but there is no direct comparison. We take it as a comparison. Sometimes questions are asked from charts which we usually ignore. You have to focus on the charts given also. Look here, the values H2O, see, the unit is common, which is coulomb square, newton to the power minus 1, meter to the power of minus 2. H2O is 78.39, D2O is 78.06, H2O2 is 70.7. So the values are decreasing from H2O to D2O to H2O2. From H2O to D2O, the decrease is very small. But from D2O to H2O2, there is a huge difference, huge decrease. Okay. So please, in this set, in this particular set, we can remember with the increasing molecular mass, with increasing molecular mass, dielectric constants are decreasing. So that's a clue for remembering this particular set. It is not valid for all, but here it is so. Okay. We proceed to the next question. Including the sign, electron gain enthalpies of oxygen family follows the order. This is from second year, P block elements. And this data is taken from the chart. See, greater the non-metallic character of an element, larger the quantity of heat liberated when it picks up an electron. So a more negative value for electron gain enthalpy suggests that the element is more non-metallic. And here, see, generally we say down the group, non-metallic character decreases and metallic character increases. So we may expect a regular decrease in the negative value or increase in the mathematical value. A decrease in the negative value means increase in the positive value. Okay. But there is a unexpected twist that the first element oxygen, is unexpectedly having very low negative value. Why? Because as in the case of fluorine, oxygen also repels an incoming electron due to its tight electron cloud. Naturally, the tendency of oxygen to gain electron has been decreased, so it will liberate less heat than required. So it happens to be the last element in the series. Look here. Sulfur, -200, the lowest value, which is lesser than selenium, -195, which is still lesser than tellurium, -190, even less than polonium, -174, all kilojoule per mole. And the oxygen is having the lowest negative value or the highest mathematical value, -141. Okay, so remember, in the case of oxygen, it is due to the tight electron clouds repulsion over the electron, that upon picking up an electron, it releases less energy than expected. Okay, see, don't think that in all periods the first element becomes last. In the nitrogen family, it takes a middle position. You have to check each and every separately and make all these by heart if possible. Okay, we go to the next question. In diborane molecule, the inner HBH, the inner HBH angle, the inner HBH angle is dashed than outer HBH angle, and the bridging BH bond length is dashed than terminal BH bond length. More or less such options are given. To get the answer, we will look into the structure of diborane. You know who introduced the structure of diborane? Willard Lipscomb, for which he was awarded Nobel Prize. Okay, look at the structure. We know it's a specialty. It is having a bridging hydrogen or banana bond is formed. That is, two electron, three centers form bonds are involved. Naturally, this compound is electron deficient compound, isn't it? So look the bond angles outside and inside, the HBH bond angle outside and inside. Outside it is 120 degree, inside it is only 97 degree. But what about the bond length? Outside it is 19 pm, outside it is 119 pm, inside it is 134 pm. See why the outer angle is greater, I will tell. See, the outer terminal BH bonds are original covalent bonds involving two atoms. So, naturally, it is a strong bond with a high electron cloud density over the bond. So, the repulsion between terminal BH bonds on each side will be very high. So, they keep maximum distance, retaining a distance of 120 degree. Whereas, think about the inner bridging bonds, BH bonds. We know two electrons are spread over three atom. So the electron cloud density is diffused. So the repulsion between the bridging bond will be comparatively less. So the two bonds can come closer. That's why there is 97 degree only. Okay. Again, we see that the outer bond length is less than the inner bond length. Again, the reason is same. Why? See, outer bond is actual covalent bond, normal two-centered bond, so tight electron cloud, so bond length will be less. Okay, on the other side, inner bond is involving two electron for three nucleus. Attractive forces are generally weak, so naturally bond length will be greater. So our answer is 3, because inner bond angle is less than outer bond angle. And outer bond length is, inner bond length is greater than outer bond length. So answer option, if you check back, is 3. Okay, we go to the next. When ammonia is heated with a diborane, first it forms an ionic pair, which later decomposes to borazine. This ionic pair is structurally 1 tetrahedral unit and 1 trigonal planar unit, 2 tetrahedral unit, 1 tetrahedral unit and a trigonal bipyramidal unit, 2 trigonal planar units. Look here. What happens here? See, B2H6 being unstable upon heating, it may first changes to be, we can imagine that things to happen like this. First, it may decompose to BH3 and BH3, and one of the H is transferred from one BH3 to the other BH3 along with the electron pair. So what happened? One become BH2 plus, the other become BH4 minus. Now in the presence of ammonia, the BH2 plus species with two vacant orbital can accommodate lone pairs of electron donated by this ammonia. So now that cation species changes to BH2NH3 twice plus charge remains there, whereas BH4 minus remains as such. See, the structures will be as shown below. Look here, the first cation BH2 NH3 NH3. See, when NH3 coordinate electron pair to boron, what happened? It acquires negative charge. See, as a whole, there is 2 plus charge and 1 minus charge in that species, resulting in 1 plus charge, isn't it? So that species is the cation. On the other side, that boron has acquired 1 H minus, so it is BH4 minus. So both these ions will be tetrahedral with the sp3 hybridization for the central boron atom. So our answer will be both tetrahedral. See, even though the question has been answered, I would like to show you the borazine structure also, the final product. See, this pair of cation upon heating rearranged to form borazine or borazole or inorganic benzene. See, you have to make these equations by heart. 3BH2NH3 twice plus BH4 minus upon heating gives two products. One is 2 moles of borazine and the other is 12 moles of hydrogen. Please make that by heart, 12 moles of hydrogen. Look at the structure of borazine. It is having a ring, planar ring of 3 boron and 3 nitrogen alternately arranged. There are 1 hydrogen on each boron. And here the pi bonds are special because the pi bonds are coordinate bonds too. That is, the lone pair of electron in nitrogen is coordinated to boron as a pi bond. So 3 coordinate bond acting as a pi electron cloud is the specialty for diborane. Okay. So please remember this equation by heart. We go to the next question. Which statement about fullerene C16 is incorrect? It has 20 carbon rings, 25 carbon ring and 12 6 carbon ring. All carbons are sp2 hybridized. Every 5 carbon ring is surrounded by 5 carbon rings. It has a delocalized 60 pi electron cloud system, making it aromatic. Okay. See, here the first statement is wrong because it has actually 12 5 carbon rings and 26 carbon rings. If you know the structure, it has 12 5 carbon ring and more is 26 carbon ring. Okay, we will see that later. All carbons are sp2 hybridized, it is true. Every 5 carbon ring is surrounded by 5 6 carbon rings. Every 5 carbon ring is surrounded by 5 6 carbon ring. That is also true. It has a delocalized 60 pi electron cloud system, making it aromatic. Okay, look at this structure. This is a 6 carbon ring. Look the rings surrounding it. This is 5 carbon. This is 6 carbon. This is 5 carbon. This is 6 carbon. This is 5 carbon. So a 6-sided ring is surrounded by 3 5-sided ring and 3 6-sided ring. What about a 5-sided ring? Look at, this is a 5-sided ring. It is surrounded by 6, 6, 6, 6, 6. All 6-sided ring. That's the difference. A 6-sided ring is surrounded by 3 5-sided ring and 3 6-sided ring. Whereas a 5-sided ring is surrounded by 5 6-sided ring. That is, in the structure, there is no 5-ring-5-ring fusion. There is no 2 5 rings are in contact. But 6-sided rings are in contact with both 6-sided ring and 5-sided ring. Only if it is arranged like that, it will become a ball shaped. Otherwise, it will go a planar shape. Okay. Okay. We go to the next question. An amphibole is a double-stranded silicate chain. its repeating unit is SiO4 11 6 minus, SiO4 Si4O12 6 minus, Si2O7 4 minus, Si2O6 4 minus. We will see the structure of this double stranded silicate. This is the structure of a double stranded silicate. See, a silicate single strand is like this. Look at the indicator goes, pointer goes. It is like this. So here we see two such strands are interconnected. Upon each second silicate unit or every alternate silicate unit are interconnected. This is not interconnected with the ring here, but this is with connected with this. Again, this is not interconnected with this. This is interconnected with this. This is not interconnected. So it is that way. Okay. So star shaped rings are developed, isn't it? Star shaped rings, as I show using the pointer, is resulted. Now, how to determine a repeating unit? See, you see, it is like a wave. This much part is a repeating unit. That part bordered by that four red lines in the diagram. That is the repeating unit. These four. Okay. That is the repeating unit. And please remember, in every silicate unit, all the corners are occupied by oxygen, whereas the center is occupied by silicon. Actually, this red is silicon. Actually, it is not visible. It should not be visible because it will be below this blue oxygen at the top of the structure, tetrahedral structure. So, to show that it is there behind the blue, we have shown this red. Actually, it will not be visible. Okay, if we look from the top. Okay, now we'll see how many silicon atoms are in this repeating unit. One silicon atom, two red, three red, four red. So, it is Si4. What about oxygen? At this division point, there will be contribution of half oxygen only. So, half plus half 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10 and half, 11. So, Si4O11. Now, we have to decide the charge. Please remember, only some oxygen will be having charge, because those oxygens which are having two covalent bonds will not carry charge. Only when those oxygen, only those oxygen which is having only one bond connected to silica unit will have a negative charge. See, look here. These terminal oxygens will have negative charge. So we start from here. This oxygen is paired, shared by two units. So it is having two covalent bonds. It will not have charge. It also will not have charge. Coming over this oxygen above that silicon. Yeah, it is not bonded to two atoms. So, it is having a charge shown by this green line. This oxygen is at the junction. So, no charge. This is free. This blue is free. So, negative charge. This and this is our junction. So, no charge. This at a, see, please remember these dotted lines are not bonds. They are showing the structure only, framework only. Only this one is the real bond with the silicon. So, this is having only one silicon bond, so one negative charge. This apex oxygen is also having one negative charge because it is not bonded to two atoms, only to one silicon atom. This, again, this blue is having one negative charge, which is at the apex. This oxygen at the border is not connected with the two atoms, only with the one silicon atom, so negative charge. This is at the junction, no charge. This is at the junction, no charge. So, altogether, there are four negative charge but a repeating unit. That's why answer is 1, Si4, O11, 6 minus. Please remember, double-stranded silicates are sometimes called amphiboles. A-M-P-H-I-B-O-L-E-S. Amphiboles. Okay, we proceed to the next question. In P4O10, there are dash 6-membered rings. Your option 1, 2, 3, 4. How many 6-membered rings? To know that, we have to look into the structure. This is the structure of P4O10. Look at this structure. You know, P4 is a tetrahedral unit with the P at all the four corners. Now, you imagine you are inserting one oxygen in all the PP bonds. There are 6 PP bonds in P4. There are 6 PP bonds in P4. If you insert oxygen in each of these bond, there will be 6 POP linkage like this. Look there, POP, POP, like that there will be 6 POP. Okay, in addition, then it becomes P4O6. In addition, when it becomes P4O10, there will be one double bonded O to the outside of the ring. Okay, this is the structure of P4O10. If we avoid the double bond oxygens, we have P4O6. So the cage like structure is common for P4O6 as well as P4O10. P4O10 have double bonded oxygen, 4 double bonded oxygen to the outside. So now the question is, how many hexagonal ring? Look here. This is one hexagonal ring, isn't it? Chair shaped. This is also similar shaped chair ring, but we by looking from this side, we will not be able to understand its actual shape. We feel it like a hexagon only, but it is also chair shaped. Actually, all are chair shaped. Look at the third one on the other side. If you look from this side, this will be a six-membered ring, isn't it? This will be a six-membered ring. And this will the base one, this will be also a six-membered ring, chair shaped. All four sides are chair shaped. Remember, tetrahedron of P are having four triangular faces. Now all these triangular faces have four, all the four triangular faces have now changed to four hexagons. Okay, so our answer is 4. Hope you understood that. And we have the last question. Not last, last question, 10th question. The bond length X and bond angle Y when compared for S6 and S8, X and Y are greater for S6, X and Y are greater for S8, X is greater for S6, Y is greater for S8, and fourth option, the reverse of this. We will check into the diagram of this molecule. Look here. See, the bond length is more when there are only 6 sites, because for S6 it is boat shaped, for S8 it is crown shaped. In S6, SS bond length is 205.7, is S8 it is 204 only. So here bond S8 bond length is less, S6 bond length is more. But what about the bond angle? In S8 it is 107. In S6, it is 102.2. So, our conclusion can be deduced from this data information. Answer is 3. Because S6 is having, look at these two values, higher bond length. And S8 is having higher bond angle. So, that combination is answer 3. So, we have completed the whole discussion. Okay. Hope you understood everything. Any doubt, you can ask me through YouTube or WhatsApp group. Okay. Take care. See you again. Bye.